Welcome to Northern France. We're in Normandy, and this is the Church of the Cosmic Vagina. Thousands of years ago, complex technology which bridged the gap between the physical world and the spiritual world was developed in Iraq, Egypt, Mexico, and European megalithic sites such as Stonehenge. Buried deep inside sacred mounds of earth in Göbekli Tepe in Turkey, in Egypt, in Iran, and Iraq, and also buried deep under the pyramids of Mexico, we have discovered statues of very strange demons. Alongside these statues are other artifacts which resemble the components of electrical circuits, such as the Jed pillar, which looks suspiciously very similar to a Tesla coil. In the ancient world, electricity was being generated using batteries filled with acid vinegar. And these devices created a flowing energy which was used by the Illuminati royal families of ancient Egypt, ancient Iraq, ancient Britain, and ancient Mexico to make psychic contact with spirits, angels, and demons. These devices, in turn, inspired the greatest scientists of the modern world, some of whom were members of secret societies which hosted seances in which ectoplasm and technological apparatus were used to show us images of the spirit world. All this technology was kept utterly secret. Welcome to the world of forbidden electrical psychic spiritual technology. Welcome to the world of forbidden TV. My name is Chris Everard, and I travel the world investigating psychic, spiritual, and technological secrets which the ruling elite have kept secret for thousands and thousands of years. In this episode, we take you on a psychedelic mystery tour and investigate the powerful mind-bending sacred plants which inspired all the great religions. These ancient plants were traded by the prehistoric druid cultures of Europe, the Olmecs of Mexico, and the pharaohs of Egypt. Some of these plants triggered telepathic psychic communication between magicians and the spirit world. And we visit crypts and temples where there are carvings and paintings that suggest some kind of psychic electrical technology was used by the magicians of ancient Egypt. This technology worked rather like an amplifier, but it was not amplifying sound, it was amplifying brain waves and boosting people's telepathic powers. We also show you how the world's first electronics billionaire, Sir Charles William Siemens, founded the world's biggest electronics corporation based on his experiments, which he conducted on top of the summit of the Great Pyramid of Cheops. We also return to the Temple of Dendera and discover a hieroglyph which represents electricity. This hieroglyph does not appear in any dictionary of Egyptian writing and proves that the apparatus carved into the crypt walls of the Temple of Hathor was used to generate some kind of electrical aura and facilitate communication with the spirit world. Just imagine if there was a herb which could make you telepathic. Well, there actually is. Even though mainstream science claims that telepathy does not exist, the chemical pharmacopoeia has named a drug found in ayahuasca and in a little shrub that grows in Syria, telepathine. Telepathine is the chemical name for a drug which creates intense feelings of psychic communication. And this drug is found in desert shrubs in Syria and also in the vines growing in the jungles of the Amazon. Telepathine is the official pharmacological name of the harmine molecule. Harmine is found in plants and some insects which grow in the Americas and also in Arabia. Both the pharaohs of ancient Egypt and the Mayans of Mexico grew plants which contain the harmine psychedelic alkaloid known as telepathine. It is a mystery how the complex recipes and extensive boiling and cooking of these plants achieved the concentrated alkaloids which priesthoods and shamans and mystics in the ancient world used during their ceremonies. But the historical use of harmine-containing herbs stretches way back into the prehistoric era of mankind. Syrian rue grows in the wild deserts of Syria, Lebanon, and Palestine. Syrian rue is gathered and traded by local magi. During the time of Jesus, at Qumran in Palestine, a group of healers called the Essene Magi wrote the mysterious Dead Sea Scrolls. The Dead Sea Scrolls contain many references to hallucinogenic plants and psychedelic mushrooms. The Magi of Palestine are the astrologers, the fortune tellers, and drug peddlers of the ancient world. Magi are featured in the nativity story of the Bible, bringing sweet incenses to the baby Jesus. one of these incenses was frankincense, which is a gum collected from the acacia tree. And acacia is one of the catalysts which amplifies the hallucinogenic telepathic powers of Syrian rue. This is a coded message put into the Bible that tells you that Jesus was a psychic. As for the Mayans in Old Mexico, the ayahuasca vine became part of their world creation myth and is featured in Mayan paintings. The ayahuasca vine also contains the telepathine alkaloid that is also found in Syrian rue. Telepathine is a highly unusual chemical. It exists in humans, animals, butterflies, and even grasses and trees. And what's really strange is that when this drug is isolated, it glows in the dark. Telepathine is a fluorescent harmala alkaloid. It occurs in a number of different plants, most notably the Middle Eastern plant Syrian rue and the South American vine Banisteriopsis capi, which is known as ayahuasca. Seven species of butterfly in the Nymphalidae family contain vast amounts of telepathine in their body and wing cells. Telepathine-containing plants include tobacco, the Syrian rue used by the Bedouin Magi, and telepathine also exists in two species of passion flower. The International Pharmacopoeia describes telepathine as a harmine alkaloid. It is potentially an amazing wonder drug. Telepathine can reverse the damaging effects of monosodium glutamate, and it is also capable of destroying leukemia cancer cells. Telepathine can fight bone degeneration diseases, and it also helps to build new cells in cartilage. Telepathine has also clinically been proven to lift people suffering from depression. In fact, it can lift you not just from depression, but can literally raise your spirit into another dimension. It is this telepathic amplification effect of harmine telepathine which has made it one of the most important substances used for psychic communication with the spirit world. Telepathine is also a monoamine oxidase inhibitor. And this means that fermented foods such as salami, pork delicatessen sausages, and beer must not be eaten or drunk for 48 hours following the telepathic experience. And it is these exact same fermented foods which have been written into ancient religions as the forbidden foods.
Uriel Seraphim.
Uriel Seraphim.
Io Modesta Izata.
Zati Zata.
Galatim Galata.
Galatim Galata.
Stone Age psychedelia is the most in-depth investigation into the kings and queens of the ancient world. It's a book which is far more than just about drugs in the ancient world. It proves that the richest families who ever walked the face of the planet gained their riches by dealing in opium, cocaine, hashish, and tobacco. Stone Age psychedelia proves that the psychedelic experience is at the root of all religions. Stone Age psychedelia is available exclusively with a free DVD documentary film from ChristopherEverard.com and also from ChristopherEverard.co.uk. Obelisks have some kind of secret. It is a secret reserved for the elite. The elite governments have invested millions of dollars in building effigies of Egyptian obelisks in many capital cities. And they've even transported original Egyptian obelisks, which now stand at the Vatican, in Rome, in London, in New York, in Paris, and many other sites. The secret to obelisks is the electrostatic power which these obelisks are able to accrue from the atmosphere. And this static electricity was stored in a battery in ancient times. And today, we call that battery the Ark of the Covenant. And now we travel to Lalibela in Ethiopia. Let us now take a much closer look at the forbidden history of the Ark of the Covenant. At churches, temples, and lodges worldwide, King Solomon is worshipped by Freemasons. Outside the entrance of Solomon's temple, there were two pillars, which are now the central emblems of Freemasonry. Inside, the Ark of the Covenant was charged with static electricity. And during festival days, and to impress the crowds, King Solomon used to discharge large arcs of static electricity from these columns. These arcs of light became known as the Golden Arches, and this in Masonic ritual as the so-called Royal Arch of Masons. The arch is actually an arc of static electricity. And King Solomon described it as serpent energy flying as sparks through the air. Just like the anti-Kythera mechanism, which was dredged up from the bottom of the sea and is at least 2,000 years old, the Ark of the Covenant was a technology reserved exclusively for the royal elite. King Solomon's family and many of the pharaohs came from Sudan and Ethiopia. Sudan was known as the land of Kush. And one of the most important arks was kept in a secret location in Ethiopia. Jewish Ethiopian mystics have concealed the Ark of the Covenant for centuries inside a little chapel on a lake in Ethiopia. The Aksumite Kingdom in Ethiopia was an empire which stretched across southern Egypt, Sudan, present-day Eritrea, and Ethiopia. Thousands of megalithic stones were inserted into the Earth's crust long before recorded history even began. Some of those prehistoric obelisks still stand to this day. Then, around 1700 years ago, new obelisks made from grey granite were placed above subterranean tombs of the Aksumite kings, who were buried in stone sarcophaguses just like the pharaohs of ancient Egypt. To this day, the Nubian Black African legacy of the pharaohs can be seen in Ethiopia, and it became a holy land when Christianity swept across East Africa, with many oral traditions teaching that the first Christian evangelists were actually black Ethiopians. The enormous 33-meter obelisk at Aksum is the second largest obelisk ever made. It's 1700 years old and is far larger than the famous Stone of the Pregnant Woman in Lebanon. In fact, the only obelisk ever built which is larger than this is the unfinished obelisk at Aswan, which is around 40 meters tall. These obelisks had several functions. Firstly, the Ethiopian obelisks were carved with false doors and false windows, and this is exactly the same as we see in mastaba tombs in Egypt. The false door is a focal point for the soul of the dead king or queen to travel through. And upon traveling through the false door, the spirit or the soul of the pharaoh will usually transform into a transhumanoid shape, perhaps taking on the form of an animal or becoming part human and part animal, such as what we see with the Sphinx. Make no mistake, these obelisks were collectors of atmospheric static electricity. And in Ethiopia, there is a strong tradition surrounding the Ark of the Covenant. There were several arks, and they were all highly guarded, super secret branches of technology, which were known only to the mega wealthy ancient elite royal families. Biblical scripture even describes the Jewish Levite priests wearing a grounding strap around their ankles before approaching the Ark of the Covenant inside the tabernacle. This grounding strap protected the priests so that they would not get an electric shock. Essentially, an Ark of the Covenant is just a box. It is what is inside this box which is really important. And this is that the Ark of the Covenants contained Leyden jars, which were capable of storing static electricity. What I've discovered over the years is that not only did the ancient pharaohs have a grand system for harnessing electrostatic electricity constantly for free from the sky, but they also developed their own battery system. It was also a capacitor and an insulator, and it collected this electricity, and then that could be transported and demonstrated wherever they wished. The first scientist to realize that static electricity was being generated by obelisks and pyramids was the scientist Sir Charles William Siemens. Sir Siemens climbed to the summit of the Cheops Pyramid and discovered an energy at the summit which is now known as the Pyramid Effect. This energy is essentially flows of static electricity which are drawn down from the atmosphere. When Sir Siemens raised his hand with his fingers outspread, an acute ringing noise was heard on the summit of the Great Pyramid. Raising just his index finger, Sir Siemens felt a prickly energy, and when he tried to drink from a wine bottle, he got a slight electric shock. Sir Siemens then moistened a newspaper and wrapped it around the bottle to convert it into a Leyden jar, and it became increasingly charged with electricity simply by being held above his head on the summit of the pyramid. Leyden jars are actually containers meant to hold and store electrical energy. In the 18th century, scientists called them condensers because electricity was believed to be a fluid, tangible substance. However, today, they are more accurately described as electrical capacitors. Now, a capacitor is usually integrated into an electrical circuit with some sort of insulator, and the Jed pillar, which can be found on the outer tomb enclosure of Tutankhamun and in millions of carvings in ancient Egypt, looks exactly like an electrical insulator. In fact, it is the Jed pillar, which we can see supporting two large apparatus in the mysterious and amazing carvings down in the crypts of the Temple of Dendera. It is very, very obvious to me indeed that there is a jagged, electrical, wavy line inside a sphere that's clearly carved into the wall of the crypt of Dendera. There is no hieroglyph in any book about Egyptology which has this design. It looks like a spark, and indeed it is a spark. When we analyze what is going on here, we can see a large rectangular box, which could be an Ark of the Covenant, full of Leyden jars, and to the left we see a large vase that could be filled with vinegar, just the same as a Baghdad battery. We then see two pairs of columns, and we see radiating lines of energy meeting between the vase and these two pairs of columns. But look very carefully. The right-hand pair have a slightly different design, showing perhaps that they are the positive and the other pair of columns are the negative. Right there, we see a jolt, a spark of electricity being carved in stone. All Egyptology students need to be made aware of this information. And we really thank everyone who's been sharing our TV series, and make sure that you actually share this episode and strike up a discussion with your friends and get this information out there. There is a longer, more in-depth version available on the Enigma channel. The Enigma channel is like WikiLeaks, but instead of reading documents about secret subjects, you can put your feet up and watch thousands of fascinating documentary films covering subjects which have been censored and suppressed from the mainstream media for decades. The Enigma channel is a 100% independent TV network with documentaries and TV shows which are not available on YouTube, not on Netflix, and are unique to the Enigma channel. If you would like to join one of our filming crews and go on an expedition to the ancient world, then you need to visit the Enigma Channel website. That's enigmachannel.com, or you can visit the members site at enigmatv.com. Use the contact form and write the word expedition in the subject heading. In exchange for a small contribution towards our filming costs, you will actually become a member of our crew. You'll be eating with us in the same hotels, you'll be traveling with us, you'll be meeting all of the authors and people which we interview. Now, every year, we are filming at amazing museums in places like Athens, Paris, Madrid, Barcelona, New York, Mexico, Egypt, you name it. You'll get to stay in haunted castles. You can visit haunted pubs. You can be taken on moonlit walks around London. And we visit many, many ancient cities. Our expeditions include lectures about things like Nostradamus, the Cathars, the Illuminati, Nikola Tesla, the Vatican, paranormal research. Believe me, it's a lot of fun. So what you do is you contact us via the Enigma Channel websites. It's enigmachannel.com or enigmatv.com. And we look forward to meeting you and look forward to inviting you as a member of our filming crew. Enigma Channel is rather like WikiLeaks, except instead of reading documents about secret subjects, you'll be watching documentary films. There are literally thousands of hard-to-find TV shows and video files which were deleted from public sharing video sites years ago, all on the Enigma Channel. It's an amazing library of knowledge. And top researchers and top authors upload their videos to the Enigma Channel first before they upload them to social media and social video sharing websites. Signing up for an account takes less than 2 minutes. It's just a small donation once a year, and that is a gateway for you to have uncensored information and professionally made HD documentaries every single day of the week. Go to enigmatv.com or our members site, enigmachannel.com. First ever high-resolution 6K image from the Temple of Dendera that clearly shows yet another strange device. I was the first ever researcher to be allowed to actually photograph these devices up close with a 6K camera. Now we can see that there is some kind of flowing energy coming from this device, which is a long tube. Is it a water pump? Is that energy water? If it is, why isn't there any record whatsoever of water pumps in ancient Egypt? Clearly, there is evidence everywhere if you want to see it, that the Egyptians were using some kind of special technology. These carvings were about 15 or 16 feet above floor level, and you can see that somebody has meticulously picked out and chipped out the actual image of the priest or the pharaoh holding these devices, and also chipped away at the actual images of the devices themselves. This could have been Christians, it could have been Muslims, it could have been other priesthoods who wanted to censor this information. There have been literally thousands of books written about ancient Egypt, and there's even been TV shows and some books written about ancient technology. However, with these new 6K cameras, this TV show that you're watching right now is the very first time we've been able to see images of this kind of detail, and it has raised a lot of important questions. Thank you very, very much for watching this episode. And if you head over to the official website, which is forbiddentv.net, you'll be able to download X-rated late-night versions of this show, which investigate voodoo and Jack the Ripper. And you can also visit the Enigma channel and get a subscription and watch literally thousands and thousands of documentaries like this that I've produced over the years. My name is Chris Everard. Thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next episode, and we are going to be visiting Iran, Syria, Tibet, Nepal, India, Spain, France, and Germany in the upcoming episodes. See you then.